Okay, welcome to the Manhattan GMAT Study Hall for October 25th. We have just begun the recording. Today's topic is this: sentence structure issues in sentence correction. Among other things, there's a couple of other miscellaneous topics in here as well, but the main theme here is sentence structure issues. Does anybody know what do we mean when we say sentence structure issues? Like, what is an issue of sentence structure? What does that mean? Anybody in the chat box? What is that? I don't think anybody's typing. If you have any idea what that might refer to, go ahead and try the chat box. Okay, fragments, that's one type of issue. Basically, it's things, not verb tense agreement. Verb tense agreement, we would say, is a verb issue. When we say sentence structure issues, what we're basically talking about is things that are supposed to be sentences, but aren't sentences. So one person mentioned fragments. That's a thing. So as an example of a fragment, if you just said something like my brother, period, that's not a sentence. Also, my friend, comma, who lives in Texas. That's not a sentence. If you don't know why not, we'll talk about it today, but that's not. There's also run-on sentences, which try to be more than a sentence, like too many ingredients for a single sentence. So there's a couple ways you can make run-ons. Like one way that you can make a run-on sentence would be to put two sentences in a row with just a comma. My friend lives in Texas, comma, he enjoys the hot weather. It's not a sentence because it's two sentences with a comma in between, and you can't do that. Or if you say something like, my friend, comma, who lives in Texas, comma, he enjoys the hot weather. This is also not a sentence. This part here in the middle is a modifier that you can ignore if you want to, but what you're left with if you ignore that modifier. Remember, when you ignore modifiers, you should get a structure that is actually a sentence. But here you get something that tries to have two different subjects. And that's not really a thing that you can have. This just tries to be subject number one. And this tries to be subject number two. And you can't do that. My friend, he enjoys this. So mostly when we talk about issues of sentence structure, we're talking about these two things: fragments, run-on sentences. Also, I mean, if you've watched enough of these by now, you probably know, but the secret to most of this is also not just knowing how this works. You also have to recognize when you are dealing with this kind of thing. So there are two goals for today. The first goal here is to understand these sentence structure errors. The second goal for today is to be able to recognize or identify these errors when you are looking at a problem. Because again, this is the big deal. I mean, there's not a lot in sentence correction that is complicated. I mean, if you think about most of the individual issues that are issues, most of them are pretty simple things. You know, like modifiers, oh, that's not describing the right thing. Or pronouns, well, that doesn't stand for that. Or parallelism, those don't look like each other. I mean, the concepts are mostly not very complicated things at all. But what's hard is that you have to identify those concepts on the fly when you are looking at problems. And so you don't want to you want to make sure you don't underestimate the challenge inherent in just recognizing what's even going on in the first place. So, smiley face if you guys understand what these things are. Fragments, run-on sentences. Remember where the smiley face is. Start looking at some problems here pretty soon. Okay, I saw like 5 smiley faces. I think a lot of people are not really there, but okay. Let's take a look. And when we do multiple choice questions here, make sure you use the multiple choice options that are here. Please do not post multiple choice answers in the chat box. Just so that everybody doesn't see what you are typing, we want to make sure that your answer doesn't influence other people. So you should see these options. When you type your response, other people will not see it. So don't be shy. Also, we'll wait a little while for people to answer the question, but the last thing to keep in mind here is the GMAT doesn't allow you to leave questions blank. It doesn't let you skip questions or leave them blank. So please answer all questions, even if you must guess in order to do so. That's the thing. Okay, there's your multiple choice answers. Also, intellectual property disclaimer here. All of the following problems are from the free GMAT prep software. Copyright GMAT. If you reproduce those questions somewhere else, make sure that you give GMAT the appropriate credit. You are allowed to distribute free GMAT prep problems because they are free. So it's freely distributed software. But please remember, we can't, and you can't either, distribute OG problems in the same sort of way. That's a different sort of intellectual property. This is why we don't use OG problems on the forum, because of these, intellectual property considerations. So just keep that in mind. But these problems are going to be from GMAT Prep. Okay, so let's go ahead and look at one of them. And let's take a look. How about this one? So here's a timer. You'll see a timer appear momentarily and give you a little bit more time than you probably need. Again, please, ladies and gentlemen, please indicate your answers in the multiple choice section. Please do not. Let me put that here on the board for you guys. Please use the multiple choice options to indicate your answer. Please don't indicate it anywhere else. Thank you. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, take a few more seconds if you need to, because I was talking there for a while. Please try to have an answer here in the next 20 seconds or so. Thanks. Okay, what I will do is go ahead and post your class answers on the board, and then we can discuss from there. Let's take a look. Here's what you guys answered as a class. So there's a lot of not agreement here. There's a lot of, in fact, there are 3 equally popular answer choices. No, let's go ahead and take a look. In particular, let's take a look at this split right here. Acting, acting, act. They act. They act. So what's in this split? Well, let's take a look at it. Notice that you've got modifiers. The first two of those things are your ing type modifiers. In other words, not verbs at all. So those, then you have act, you have a verb, and then you have a subject plus a verb. So does anybody know what you should think about when you see this kind of stuff in a split? Like, what is probably the issue here? Does anybody know? Text box. People are being very shy. Does anybody have any ideas what the issue is when you see those kinds of elements in a split? Peter says what a modifier refers to, possibly, although that's not really going to, if you do that, you're not really using the split. I mean, you should, yes, you should think about what the modifier describes, but it doesn't really use the split. Like, how do we resolve a split like this? In other words, the question that we're asking, put another way, is like, what happens if a modifier is replaced by a subject plus verb, or by a verb? I mean, this is the point, right? I mean, what someone says, we should think about what the modifier refers to. That's true. We probably should think about that. But when we talk about reserving or resolving the split, that doesn't really resolve the split. That's just an issue isolated in one of those choices. So again, let me just type that. It's yes, you should think about this too, but this isn't what resolves a split between modifiers and other stuff. You know, because we're trying to figure out whether you want a modifier in the first place or whether you don't. So let's consider the following sentences. In fact, we can make sentences a lot like the ones on the opening page. So, say something like this. My friend lives in Texas versus my friend who lives in Texas. Like, notice what's going on here as far as replacement goes. We've got the same sort of replacement that happens in that split up there. Like, lives is just a verb, and then who lives there is a modifier. So, what's the effect? If we try to put periods after those, then what happens? Yeah, the second looks incomplete. The second is quite incomplete, right? Like, in this case, you have, like, the first one is a complete sentence. Second one's not a complete sentence because you don't have a main verb. Because, okay, like, the whole point, if you want to look at this from a more general standpoint, basically modifiers are, like, non-elements when it comes to the overall structure of a sentence. Because remember that you can eliminate modifiers when it comes to grammar, but you can't eliminate things like verbs and subjects. So if you see this kind of split, that's what you're dealing with. You're dealing with things that either create sentences or don't create sentences. So if modifiers are replaced by elements that can't be eliminated, so where modifiers can be eliminated. So if you see a split between modifiers and elements that can't be eliminated, what you need to do is consider the effect on the overall structure of the sentence. And what that means is you should look out for things like run-ons and fragments. Like run-ons are things that have too many elements to be a sentence. Fragments are things that don't have enough. So, I mean, here's one example where you actually want a verb. You want my friend lives, because you have to have something whose subject is my friend. But again, you don't always want a verb. It depends on what's in the rest of the sentence. Like if you had, I could also make an example where you would want it to be the other way around. Like if you said something like, my friend is a sales manager who lives in Texas versus my friend is a sales manager lives in Texas. This time the verb makes it incorrect because you don't, now you have two verbs. So like this one works. This one doesn't work because it tries to have two verbs. So it's a run-on. It has too many elements. You have is a sales manager, and you have lives in Texas. If you had an and or some word like that to connect those, then you would be fine. But here you don't have any such connector, so you're not fine. So smiley face, if you understand this idea, that when you see a split between modifiers and things that aren't modifiers, there's usually going to be some greater issue of sentence structure. Give me a smiley face icon if that makes sense. So let's take a look at these choices in that light. So let's import this into the next page. And then go from there. Okay. Here's that. You'll see the problem show up on your screen in a second. And here's this. Okay, so let's take a look at that. Well, how does although work? Does anybody want to give me a summary of how that should function? Because remember, why are we looking all the way up there? The reason we're looking all the way back at although is because we need to think about overall structure. So we need to think about how the entire sentence is constructed from post to post here. So who wants to summarize how although works in a sentence structure? What needs to be there if although is used correctly? This is a very shy crowd today. I think exactly one person is typing. Let's see, although you actually can't, although it doesn't go with but also. In fact, you probably wouldn't use both of those. So yeah, you guys are basically saying Kesha, Keisha, and Peter. Remember how all of those works. You should make your own sentences, by the way, and figure this out. So remember how all those works, and then use your own examples if necessary. Like, if you said something like, although I left home early, I still got to work late. So notice how this functions, right? You've got to, this part alone would be a sentence, and this part here would be another sentence. So you've got two things that are individually complete sentences. So, and then that's what although links that. So this would be a complete sentence by itself. And this would also be a complete sentence. So think about that. Although ice particles in the upper atmosphere benefit Earth, so this is a complete sentence, this thing about ice particles benefit Earth. Like that's a sentence. So, and then there should be a comma there. If there wasn't a comma there, there should be one. Let me put it in there. If that's part of the difficulty people had here, then that's understandable. Should definitely be a comma right there. At the end of this line, there should be a comma. Maybe that'll help people. But although complete sentence, comma, so you need another complete sentence after that. So the problem with choice B, remember choice B was actually pretty popular. If you look at what's going on here, this is just a modifier. And so's while also accelerating is also a modifier. So you don't actually have anything that makes that a sentence in B. And so that's a fragment. So again, this is acting ing, that's just a modifier. And then that's another modifier while accelerating. So no sentence here. This is a fragment. The although part is legit. The part right after although is a sentence, but not the rest of it. And then what you've got in part C, so B is like, again, make your own examples to help you understand why answer choices are wrong. To help you understand why answer choices are incorrect, make your own analogies. Like, make sentences that work the same way. So choice B is a lot like saying, although I left home early, still getting to work late. So if you understand, if you can make that example, that means you totally understand what is wrong with B. C is not a fragment, C is a run-on because it's got too many elements. It's got too many verbs. It's got to add. C is like saying, although I left home early, still got to work late. I mean, there's no subject here. So you have two verbs, but remember that this is supposed to be a sentence. So I guess you'd call that part a fragment. It doesn't have a subject. It's just a random verb kind of sitting there. Where's the subject? So same sort of thing here. You don't have a subject here. This is just act as. That's just a verb. So any questions about choices B and C? If you have questions, go ahead and type those in the text box. And then choice D, just a one-off. There's a couple of things that you could capitalize on here, but the thing that I want to make sure you see in D is the fact that there's this pronoun here that is singular. You have this it pronoun. There's no it. I mean, it's ice particles in the atmosphere. That's what accelerates this stuff. So D is incorrect because it tries to use a plural. It tries to use a singular pronoun to stand for that plural. D tries to use it to stand for ice particles. So not okay because ice particles is plural. So D is also not okay. But B and C are not sentences in this problem. They both are missing fundamental elements that sentences have to have. So, and again, you need to make sure that you understand why they are not sentences. This is a very big thing. And just as importantly, you have to make sure that you understand why you would be looking at that. Because you're definitely not going to be examining the complete structure of every single sentence that you ever see. If you do, then there's going to be a lot of time wastage there. But if you understand why B and C are not sentences, then you're good. So we're left with A and E. Let's go ahead and take a look at those two. Does anybody have any inputs on A and E? These are both also very popular choices in the crowd. How would you decide that? As a hint, it's not anything that has to do with grammar. Looks like a couple people erased what they wrote. So someone said that E sounds correct. I mean, that's basically that something that just isn't worth anything either way. Like, this is also not a reason. This is not a reason to pick E, but it's also not a reason to avoid E either. So, like, you just have to ignore this. So that is, I mean, it may sound correct, it may not, depends on your ear, but I mean, if you think this, you should just ignore it. Because remember, spoken language is not relevant here. We're testing the written language. But I mean, the point is that, like, I mean, Keisha, I don't know where you're going with that, but if you're saying that's a reason to actually eliminate that choice, then you should be careful. Because, I mean, there are wrong answers that sound wrong, and there are right answers that sound good, too. I mean, you know, in other words, don't pick a choice because it sounds good, but don't eliminate a choice because it sounds good either. I mean, you know, there's just no relationship at all. You have to just ignore it. So, okay. E is not, there's no grammar problem. Like, E is also a sentence. I mean, you've got although, sentence, sentence, but, sentence. A is although, sentence, modifier, other sentence. So that's not the issue. The issue is meaning. I mean, remember how although works. It works in, let's go ahead and put this on another page. The way although works is it has to actually introduce a contrast. Like you actually have to have things that are in contrast with one another in order to use although. So consider the meaning of a sentence with although. So here's the example that I gave, which was a pretty simple example. Although I left home early, I still got to work late. I mean, there's a contrast here. These two things are in opposition to each other. Like the idea of leaving home early and the idea of getting to work late are in contrast. This probably seems really obvious in these terms, but that's how although functions. So you got to think about what the sentence is actually saying. because you gotta know what's supposed to contrast with what else. So, like, what are the ideas in this sentence? Because you have to know what's supposed to contrast with what. So you've got ice particles. Well, according to the first part of the sentence, ice particles benefit Earth by reflecting and, you know, by doing stuff with radiation. The second part of the sentence is they act as a global thermostat. In other words, they prevent, like, freeze over or burn, or, like, burning down. They prevent both of those, so I guess I should put and there. And then finally, they also accelerate destruction of ozone. So, I mean, where's the contrast here? There's three ideas here. Someone tell me which of these ideas are on the same team and which of these ideas are not on the same team. If you have ideas like 1, 2, 3, which ideas are on the same side of the issue? Yeah, it's 1 and 2 are, because 1 and 2 are things that are good about ice particles in the upper atmosphere. And number 3 is something that is bad or, you know, not good about those. Something that is pernicious. So it's those 2, but that last 1. So that's why E doesn't make sense. It's not really a structural issue. But E says, although they benefit Earth, comma, they keep Earth from burning up. I mean, that's not a contrast. So that sentence doesn't make any sense. A does make sense. Because you've got, although they do this, comma, and here's a modifier that tells me how they do that. So all of this is one sentence with a modifier in A. Although they benefit Earth, comma, here's a modifier saying how they do that, comma. So if you want to color match that, the red idea corresponds to this much of that sentence. And then the following sentence is the idea that's in that sort of aqua color, which is on the other side of the issue. Oh, look, there's something bad. Although I left home early, I got to work late. Although these things benefit Earth, they also accelerate the destruction of ozone. So sentence E doesn't do that properly. Sentence E breaks up the construction in the wrong place. So it looks like there's a fake contrast where it's not supposed to be a contrast. So that means that the correct answer here is A. Any questions? I see some of you are typing. So go ahead and, if you have questions, fire away. The acting is a modifier that describes, if you don't know how comma ing modifiers work, you should check out our modifiers book, because we, our sentence correction book modifiers chapter, because we have an extensive treatment of this kind of modifier. So, comma acting describes the previous sentence. So it describes the fact that these things reflect and absorb solar rays, benefit Earth by reflecting and absorbing stuff. So modifies the previous idea. That's what you want. If you don't know how comma ing works in general, then you should consult the SC strategy guide. The but here, I mean, you've got to think about what the sentence means. You could have a but in this kind of thing if it made sense. I mean, there's a more general response that needs to be given here, and I'll tell you what that is. But, you know, the answer to this is sure if it makes sense. So there's going to be a specific answer to this question, and there's going to be a more general advice that I'm going to give you. But the specific answer is sure if it makes sense. So, like, for example, although I left home late, I still made it to the store before closing, but everything I wanted to buy was gone. So, I mean, this makes sense, right? Like, although I left home late, I still made it. There's your contrast, but then there's another contrast. I still made it to the store, but all the stuff I wanted to buy was gone. So, I mean, this is, you know, this is fine. This is a perfectly normal sentence construction. The general advice here is that trying to do this is not really going to pay dividends for you. I mean, you can't really... Like, don't try to, like, memorize entire sentence structures as right or wrong. I mean, in other words, I get the motivation behind this question, and it's not a good motivation. Like, what you're trying to do here is you're trying to, like, memorize a sentence structure so that you don't have to think about what it means. And, I mean, that's not going to work. You can't really do that. You know, you will have to think about the message of a sentence to evaluate whether things like although or but, etc., actually make sense. Like, you're not going to be able to memorize entire sentence structures and be like, I don't like that. I mean, it's totally going to be an issue of what is the underlying meaning. Peter, I think we have covered those questions in the last 5 or so minutes of discussion. So, I mean, the short answers are that's not the right interpretation for this problem. I mean, the red things are not in contrast with each other. And this that we've just done here was addressing the issue of it could still be grammatically fine, and it could still be a correct sentence in another context. So those are issues that we have just finished discussing. If you missed part of that discussion, go ahead and check out the video when it comes online next week. If anybody has questions that we haven't discussed, please go ahead and post them. Otherwise, we'll move on to another problem. Okay. How about this one? I know this problem is somewhat infamous on the forum and such, but here's a timer. This problem's got more words than most other problems, so feel free to take a little bit more time. Okay, we still have some non-responses. Please take, if you need to take 15 more seconds, feel free. Please answer the question. Thanks. Okay. Looks like just about everyone has answered except for people who are having some issues with their connection. So here are your class statistics. So there is a decently strong majority in favor of E. Again, this is one of the more well-known problems on the forum, so there might be a factor of people having seen this already. But regardless, let's take a look at it. So again, remember today's focus. I mean, there's a lot of things that we could talk about, and these problems are all from GMAT prep. So as announced in the beginning, that's correct. Remember that today's focus is what we should focus on today, because it's today's focus. Today's focus is issues of sentence structure. And remember, your hint for issues of sentence structure is that you'll encounter like a split of some kind between modifiers and core elements. What I mean by core elements is like subject or verb type thing. So where do we see that? Well, look at the very first split. You've got that's got a verb in it. That's got a verb in it. That doesn't. That doesn't. And that doesn't, but we've got to look at the rest of it too. So that's, let's color code. Let's make this color stand for things that have verbs. And then let's make this color, which will not be there just yet, stand for things that are not verbs or that are just modifiers or whatever. So let's change the color accordingly. So those first two things have verbs, but these don't. So that should be that color. That should be that color. That should be that color. And then the end of the sentence also matters because we're looking for things that are, oh, you know, like actual full sentence structure. So that's a verb. That's a verb. And then these other things are not verbs. So this isn't, that's a modifier. That's a modifier. And there's an and there. This is a modifier. And I mean, the point here is you have to have a sentence. What that means in this case is that we want to have one green thing and we want to have one purple thing. Because if we have two green things, like choice B, then you're looking at something again, like my brother is a sales manager, lives in Texas. You can't do that. So B has two green things, which is two verbs. That's a lot like my friend is a sales manager, lives in Texas. It doesn't work, right? You can't have two verbs like this. You can't say is, comma, lives. And then C and D don't have verbs at all. C and D are not even sentences. They lack verbs altogether. So this is like saying my friend who is a sales manager and lives in Texas. So just using issues of overall structure of the sentence, we can kill these two choices. So any questions about that? You have a question about those three answer choices, feel free to post it in the chat box. But again, the main issue, like once this is pointed out to you, it's probably kind of obvious. Like when you're looking at this, in this light of, hey, ladies and gentlemen, you look here. It's probably not that hard to see what's going on here at all. But the challenge, again, is not I see what's going on. The challenge is I have to spot this myself. So make sure you don't underestimate the job of this, of finding this problem. So, yeah, there's also some parallelism issues, right? Beginning and that ends. So that doesn't, I mean, B and C also have these parallelism issues. Remember, we're trying to focus today on not that. I mean, well, just for the sake of completeness, I'll go ahead and note that here on the board. But B, make sure you notice that B and C also have clear non-parallelism. Like, B has begins and ended. C has beginning and that ends. So that doesn't, right, you can also do that. But the goal of today is to get you to notice these things, to notice the green, purple issues. Any questions there? Okay, so let's take a look at A and E. This problem kind of has been done to death in the past, so on the forum and elsewhere. So I'm going to keep this discussion really, really brief, but I'll give you a quick rundown of how to decide between A and E. Here's how you would do that. So what you've got in A here, I mean, remember how comma ing modifiers have to work. A super, super brief discussion. I mean, there are entire study hall sessions where we have not so brief discussions of this. So the comma ing is basically it should describe the whole idea of the preceding clause in some way. Like, there's a few ways it could work. Like, it could describe an immediate result of that previous clause. It could describe a way in which that statement is true or works. It could, you know, give a more specific description of the preceding statement, etc. So, in fact, if we look back at this problem about ice particles in the atmosphere, that's how that, we might as well talk about that really quick, because it's right here. In the correct answer, which is A, luckily it's the piece that's right there, acting as a global thermostat and keeping Earth from burning up or breezing over, that's an elaboration on how the ice particles do this. Like, they benefit Earth by doing this. To which readers might be like, okay, how? How do they benefit Earth? Oh, here's how they do these things. So that's a description of how that works. That's the problem. That's one of the proper uses of a comma ing modifier. More to the point, it just gives you a description of the preceding sentence. I mean, you don't need to endlessly classify different ways that your comma ing could work. Like, you actually, in other words, you don't need to make a list like this one. I mean, this is a list of samples, but as long as you get the idea that this kind of modifier is supposed to somehow actually describe the idea that comes before it, then you are fine. So that's the problem here with choice A, is that it doesn't do that. Like, let me give you a couple of simpler examples first. Like, if you say, Stuart is one of the highest achieving students in the class, comma, standing almost 7 feet tall. That is nonsense, but Stuart is one of the highest achieving students in the class. comma, scoring at the top of the scale on almost every exam. So, I mean, these are both grammatically fine sentences, but the first one is total nonsense, and the second one is a sensible sentence. Because, I mean, being 7 feet tall, Stuart may be almost 7 feet tall, good for him, good luck finding clothes that fit, but he's not going to, that has nothing to do with his being a high-achieving student. On the other hand, scoring at the top of the scale on almost every exam gives a description of how Stuart is high-achieving, so that makes sense. The problem with choice A is that it's like the first sentence here. Like, choice A is saying, like, the letters were written over XXXX time period, comma, outnumbering her letters to anyone else. I mean, the problem is that this doesn't describe this. Like, this is just a time period. But this is a comparison to her letters to anyone else. And, I mean, that's not really a thing, because she could have written to anyone else over the same time period. Like, in other words, the brown thing here doesn't really help to explain or describe the blue thing in any way. Like, there's no significant relationship to the blue thing. I mean, it's not as obvious as in the case of Stuart standing almost 7 feet tall, partially because that's such a shorter sentence. It's whatever a sentence is shorter, it's clearer when these things are happening. But the period of time doesn't guarantee anything about the number of letters written. There's not really an intimate relationship here. So, I mean, unless you make up stuff, like if you make up the fact that she didn't write letters to anyone else for more than a little while, but we don't know that, you would just be making that up. Like, E doesn't have this problem because E just says which were written. Like, this describes the letters to Susan Huntington Dickinson, but it doesn't assume any relationship to the following clause. Like, so in, back to Stuart and his height and his KK, an example of the correct brown thing would be this brown thing right here, the one that actually describes why Stuart is a high-achieving student. So that's an example of how that could be correct. If you're asking for making it correct in this sentence, you can't do that because there's not a relationship. I mean, you can't use that kind of construction unless there is a relationship, which in this sentence there's not. So there's no way to make that fit this sentence. But this if your question is, how do you make that construction work in general, then here's an example. Choice E is like saying Stuart, comma, who stands almost 7 feet tall, is one of the highest achieving students in the class. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that sentence, because when you say who or which or whatever, you don't assume any kind of relationship to what is happening there. Okay, again, we don't want to go off on this particular tangent for any longer, because it's not the point of today. The point of today is this, which is when you see a split between core element and modifiers, you should be like, oh, well, because, I mean, the point is when you see that kind of split, it's impossible for both of those to work. Like, if a sentence works with a verb somewhere, then it will not work without that verb there. I mean, that's kind of the point here. Because a modifier is like a nothing from the standpoint of grammar. It's a thing that you can eliminate. So you either basically need a verb somewhere or you don't. That's the power of this kind of split, is that when you see this, you either have a sentence or you don't. So let's see if we can knock out another couple problems here. If you have questions, go ahead and throw them in the box, but we will move on. How about Let me find it. How about this one? So, give that a shot. Let's clear out your answers. There's a lot of words, so again, I'll give you a little bit of extra time. So, there you go. Yeah, the previous answer is E. Okay, we've still got a few non-responses. So if you got to guess something, then guess something. Okay, let's discuss. When you look at this, what you should see, again, you don't remember that you shouldn't be checking this out randomly. Like when you do this kind of topic-based practice, make sure that you don't randomly get into the habit of like, oh, I'm just looking for this just because. Like remember when you study, don't forget to have a reason for looking at whatever you're looking at. Like in other words, you should identify the hint or clue that indicates whatever type of issue. So for, as we've been saying, for overall sentence structure, that hint or clue is split between modifier and essential element of the sentence. So let's see if we have that kind of thing going on here. I mean, you kind of know we will because that's today's theme, but still, we should be able to identify it. So notice that that's not a verb. That's a modifier. So modifier or not verb in this color. Were taken is a verb. Having been taken is not. Were taken is not a verb because of that here. It's like my brother who lives in Texas versus my brother lives in Texas. That were taken doesn't count as a verb because it's a modifier. And then having been taken. But then this is a verb. So let's say that color is actually verb. Okay. And then, how do these things work? These are also part of the construction. Remember, you got to look at the whole construction of the sentence once you've identified that this works the way that it does. So, because though and with don't work the same way here. Like, though works like although, as described earlier in today's session. Like, you could say something like, though I left home early, I still got to work late. But with is just a preposition, so. So it's not followed by a sentence. It should be followed by a noun, possibly with modifiers. So these don't work the same way, and you have to understand how they do work. Like this, though I left home early, that's a sentence. I still got to work late is also a sentence. That's not how with works, so you got to make sure you're using these correctly. Like if you say, if you had a sentence like with three small children at home, comma, Rachel doesn't have much time for hobbies. So if you put a sentence after with, this wouldn't work, right? Three small children at home is not a sentence. It's just children. With, you know, it's got adjectives and stuff on it. Small is an adjective and at home is a modifier. But it doesn't work the same way. And I mean, you don't memorize these things. You just, like, make up your own examples and see how they work. So this is basically just a noun with stuff that describes it. But this is a sentence. So A and C don't work here because A and C, you would have to have a blue thing for this to be a sentence, right? Some, like the idea is though some. By the way this whole thing works, you should notice as well. This first yellow part up here is a sentence all by itself, so we don't really need to concern ourselves much with that part of the structure. And blah, 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 so the rest of this, the underlined part needs to be another sentence. This is like blah, 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 and other sentence. So the problem with A and C is A and C are like, though I, having left home early, comma, I still got to work late. I mean, you can't, you need to have a sentence there. So these don't work. Those weren't very popular with you guys, but they're incorrect. D, with blah, 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 okay, that works. E, with blah, 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 modifiers, that also work. So, but A and C are not sentences in this problem. Again, that's the essential element for today, for this theme that we're talking about now. We quickly will look at the rest of the issues, not all of them, but we'll look at some additional issues in this problem. But everybody, smiley face if you understand the whole idea that A and C are not actually sentences here. Like you would need a sentence after though. So like all though. Okay, lots of smileys. It's good. Okay, here are some additional issues just to, let's get through this quickly and that way we can have time to do another problem. Let's take a look at that. It'll show up on your screen momentarily. One issue is parallelism. Like you've got great, and you've got blah, 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 and in, watch out for that. And in the intensity of industrialization. So woe be on the lookout. It's not just and the, I mean, it's you need to have something that matches and in the intensity of industrialization. So you must have in something else. Blank and in the intensity. That's a parallel structure. So you would want to have, because I mean, the way they're doing this is either great population increases or increases in population, but either way, by themselves, those would be fine. But the problem is that you want increases in something or in something else. So the ones that do that correctly are this one. Let's highlight that in green to match the text up there. A does that correctly. So does B. I mean, A's already been eliminated, but population increases doesn't, in population does, population increases doesn't. So this is one reason to kill E. And then there's a couple things wrong with D as opposed to B. Can anybody give me one issue with choice D? There's at least two things there that are problems. Life here is not such a problem if we do mean that the protective measures are similar to those. I mean, if you generally such as is a better guess than like. But here it's not totally unreasonable to think that we actually might mean like that we might mean things that are similar to that. Yeah, parallel structure is one, right? That we're taking. Well, the parallel structure here, you'd probably say national forests and wildlife sanctuaries. That's not really unparalleled. Let's talk meaning for a second. Yeah, no clarity on the contrast. Sam's thinking about what the sentence means. Remember, guys, you can't really not think about what the sentences mean. I mean, like, if you have, quote, with blah, 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 comma, blah, 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 then, like, the two parts should reinforce each other. Remember the example that we gave, you know, like with three small children at home, Rachel doesn't have much time for hobbies. So, I mean, in that sentence, like the whole, you know, there's a very intimate reinforcing relationship here. Like the reason, I mean, the sentence doesn't explicitly spell it out because, you know, it doesn't have to, it's really clear. But the reason why Rachel doesn't have a lot of time for hobbies, or a reason why Rachel has very little time for hobbies, is that she has three small kids running around the house. So, I mean, the point is there's not a contrast. If there were a contrast here, it would be inappropriate. So, like, if you have, this makes sense. This is a sentence that works. If you said something like, with three small children at home, Rachel has loads of free time for hobbies. Again, there's no grammar issue in this sentence, but this is a complete nonsense sentence. You would want to have like an although or something like that, you know, despite would work. Despite having three small children at home, Rachel has loads of free time for hobbies. Like this, now that we've added despite here, this actually makes sense again. Because, oh, look, contrast. So now we have something that is sensible again. So this makes sense. So D has this issue that it doesn't, D is like the second sentence here. Like D is like saying with three small children at home, Rachel has loads of free time. It seems to create this idea that having three small kids at home gives you free time, which is obviously not true. So D is nonsense in that way. I mean, the point is that despite these protective measures, there's still a worldwide ecological crisis. I mean, these are not empty words, guys. You have to think about what they mean. So it's not with protective measures here, that doesn't make any sense. So that's one thing that is very seriously wrong with choice D. Another thing that's an issue here is that this is modifying the wrong thing. This thing right here that says that were taken decades ago. That's supposed to be describing protective measures, but if you look at the way this is punctuated, like this is mistakenly describing wildlife sanctuaries. Because, I mean, in B, it's not like you've got protective measures, comma, modifier, blah, 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 comma. So there's your subject, there's your verb. Although some protective measures were taken decades ago. But here, blah, 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 comma, like establishing this and wildlife sanctuaries that were taken. I mean, that were taken is clearly pointing to wildlife sanctuaries here, and that doesn't make sense. So that doesn't work. Such as versus like we already discussed, but the basic deal there is that they both kind of make sense here. Like it's such as is probably better because these are probably meant to be examples, but like is not super clearly incorrect here because we could mean protective measures. We could mean protective measures that are actually similar to these. So, okay. So this is be like boy. The main thing that we want to get out of this today is again modifier versus essential element. So if you got that good, because I did arrive on this scene a little bit late, we can probably do one more problem. So let me figure that out. The one we just got done seeing was B, like boy. I mean, we eliminated all the other choices. So, there you go. Which was the previous one? What was the sentence about? Just type a few of the words that were in the sentence. And then, the one about ice particles was the original version was right. Choice A in the problem about ice particles and ozone layer and stuff. Okay, try this problem. I'm gonna clear out your answers. Give it a shot. There's a timer. Go for it. Okay, we still have a rather large number of non-responses, so it's been kind of a while at this point, so please pick something. I'll give you 15 more seconds for that. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, so here are the answers that the class picked. Looks like some of you are still changing answers around. Remember how the GMAT works, you kind of have to commit. I mean, even if you're not real sure, a big part of the art of this test is just picking something and getting the heck out there. So don't underestimate that aspect, just the being deliberate and not wavering back and forth aspect. But here's what you pick. So I mean, there's a lot of dissension on this problem. But again, the deal is, I mean, I think you get the picture by now. But the point that remains here is, again, if you see modifiers versus essential elements, versus verb, think about the overall structure of the sentence. So let's see, what are modifiers here? Well, the things that are ings are modifiers. So those are modifiers. This is a modifier. This is a modifier. This is nothing else in there is modifiers. And then the things that are verbs, let's just quickly highlight those. Those are verbs. That's a verb. That's a verb. Required, mandated, granted, mandated, required, mandated, required, granted, granted, mandated, required, granted. And I mean, remember that you've got to get the meaning of the sentence. The first thing you have to understand is, what are we even talking about here? So let's address that first. Well, what are we even talking about in the first place? I mean, the thing that's important to realize is that you absolutely do not want to put all of these things in parallel, because we are talking about an ordinance about bicycle rules, basically. So, like, about bicycle rules, this whole idea should not be parallel to anything else, because it's not about bike rules and X. It's just about bike rules. So this should not be parallel to anything else, because it's not parallel to any other ideas. But then if you keep looking, then you have this ordinance did three things. I mean, then these should clearly be parallel. It's like a list of bullet points. It mandated a speed limit. It required feet and hands in place, to be in place. And then it also granted right of way to pedestrians. So whenever you have like a A, B, C list of bullet points kind of thing, then those should definitely be parallel. So these guys should be in parallel, these three, but not to the fourth item. So just when you read the sentence, regardless of whatever like splits you see, you should be noticing that this is what is actually going on. So these should be parallel. So I mean, if you realize that actually, then you're already down to C and E, because those are the only ones that have these three items in parallel, and properly so. Like, if you look at the rest of the choices, mandated, required, and it granted, the it here is the spoiler. If you don't understand why, then watch the study halls on parallelism. There's plenty of examples of that. The granting here spoils it. It's mandated, required, granting. And then same thing, but other way around. So those three are not parallel. But let's talk about overall sentence structure now. I mean, let's eliminate all the fluff here and look at overall sentence structure. So even the ones we've eliminated, like A seems to be like a structure that's fine. It just has bad parallelism, and it tries to put regulated in parallel to the other stuff. B is like I ate dinner, comma, drank. Or like drank some cognac, comma, got dressed, comma, heading to the club to meet friends. This doesn't work, right? This is not a sentence. Like, you can't do this. You need to have a connector between these verbs. Like, you can't just say verb, comma, verb, comma, verb. You would need to have, like, an and in here somewhere. So C is required, mandated, required, and it granted. So actually you've got the same issue that we talked about before. I don't know why we didn't notice that before. Mandated, required, and it granted. Again, if you don't know why the it is a problem, watch some of the earlier study halls on parallelism. C is not problematic sentence structure-wise, but it is problematic in terms of parallelism. And then D is like my friends coming out with us, comma, eating dinner, comma, drinking a little cognac, comma, and headed to the club. I mean, I don't have any idea what you would call this error, but I think it's pretty clear that there's an error here. So you can't, this is not, if you want to call it a parallel error, then you can, but this is also not a sentence. It's not parallel, it's also not even a sentence. So that leaves us with our friend choice E, which is also the correct answer. Boom. Okay, we have to know KK would still be wrong because of this. You would still not have the things that are supposed to be parallel in parallel. The ideas would still be wrong. Like you have this plan which did A, B, and C, and that choice wouldn't convey that, even if you did that too. You can do that. There's, like I said, we're not going to talk about everything in every sentence, so yeah. Okay, we have to shut down here pretty much right now. So if you have super, super fast questions, then fire away, but we've got to kill it here in a hurry. So thank you for attending, as usual. The next session should be in 2 weeks. And thanks. And hope you have a good 2 weeks. Good night and good luck. Someone's asking about the advanced workshop. I actually don't teach the advanced workshop, so I don't really know off the top of my head what is in it. So I actually have no idea of the answer to that question. Recording, I'm going to stop here. Again, good night, good luck.